Hello friends, welcome to another episode by Engineering Today, and hope you're all doing well. Today we'll share three updates with you, commencing with the successful launch of SpaceX's Inspiration 4. We'll discuss a recent photograph of a giant claw associated with SpaceX's booster, and finally discuss about Japan Telecom's partnership with SpaceX's Starlink. Let's start with SpaceX's successful launch of the all-civilian Inspiration 4 mission into orbit. On the 15th of September, Wednesday, SpaceX had successfully carried out the launch of the Inspiration 4 mission. With this, SpaceX made history of launching all civilian crew to orbit. At 8:02 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, the crew capsule was launched atop a Falcon 9 rocket from the Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center, Florida. SpaceX teams used the twice-flown booster B-1062 for this mission. After separation, B-1062 landed on the drone ship, just read the instructions. With the successful recovery of the Falcon booster, SpaceX nailed booster landing for 92nd time. SpaceX President and Chief Operating Officer Gwynne Shotwell stated regarding the mission that the all-civilian Inspiration 4 astronauts are paving the way for a future where space is more accessible to all who wish to go. And we're so proud that they entrusted us to fly them. On behalf of all SpaceX employees, I want to thank the crew and their families for allowing us to be a part of their historic mission. Musk himself was present before the mission. Musk's presence was greeted by the Inspiration 4 Twitter page. They tweeted, "Thank you for visiting our hashtag Inspiration 4 crew before their departure to Launch Complex 39A at Elon Musk." Before the launch, Mark Van de Hei from the International Space Station wrote, "All the best to the crew of the Inspiration 4. Private astronaut missions are part of the plan to help NASA meet its future needs. These missions enable a strong market in low Earth orbit, a market in which NASA will be one of many customers. Go, Inspiration, go." Nearly 2.5 minutes after launch, the booster engines were cut off and then separated. The second stage engines continued to ignite for the next 6 minutes, and the crew capsule was placed in a parking orbit 200 kilometers above ground. SpaceX tweeted, "Main engine cutoff and stage separation confirmed. Second stage engine burn underway." Report says the crew capsule got separated from the second stage nearly 12 minutes after liftoff. The crew capsule will use its built-in thrusters to get to the final orbit of 575 kilometers. Jared Isaacman, the billionaire entrepreneur who is also the commander of this mission, stated during the mission, "Few have come before and many are about to follow. The door is now open and it's pretty incredible." Isaacman had also stated earlier, "Our crew carries the responsibility and importance of the mission that we prepare to blast off. We've been well prepared for the challenges ahead of us the next 3 days and look forward to sharing our experience with the world as we continue to bring attention to St. Jude Children's Research Hospital here on Earth." Haley Arsenault, the cancer survivor and also mission specialist, said in a pre-launch conference, "I'm really excited to see the Earth from space. It's going to be so incredible." The crew capsule, which SpaceX used for this mission, is named Resilience. This spacecraft was first used for the Crew 1 mission. This was the second mission for Resilience. The only difference in the spacecraft is that earlier it had a docking mechanism at the top, but this time the vehicle had a glass cupola in place of the docking mechanism, as the capsule will not dock in the space station. Resilience is designed to be fully autonomous, thus it didn't need any onboard piloting. The vehicle is controlled from SpaceX ground stations, but the four crew members are well trained to control the Dragon capsule in case of any anomaly. According to some reports, the Dragon spacecraft will splash down either on the 18th or 19th of September. Isaacman provided us the details that the Dragon has the ability to hold back the crews in space for almost a week if the spacecraft delays to come back for poor weather or any other issues. Apart from being an all-civilian space tour mission, the mission also effectively marks the fourth crew mission under SpaceX outside NASA. Other milestones achieved include Shianne Proctor becoming the first black female pilot of spaceflight. Proctor said, "I have this opportunity to not only accomplish my dream, but also inspire the next generation of women of color and girls of color, and really get them to think about reaching for the stars." Haley Arsenault becomes the youngest American citizen to fly in space. Another milestone is the highest number of astronauts is also achieved. At present, 14 astronauts are there in space. It comprises 7 astronauts on the International Space Station, 3 astronauts from the Chinese Space Station, and 4 civilian astronauts in the Inspiration 4 mission capsule. SpaceX has also made it possible to have 3 Dragon spacecraft in orbit, 1 Crew Dragon Endeavour, and 1 Cargo Dragon docked to the space station and the Dragon capsule of this mission. This mission will also reach the highest altitude at 575 kilometers in a private crewed flight. This altitude is actually higher than both the space station and the Hubble Space Telescope. Isaacman said in a press conference, "We want to make life multiplanetary, and that means putting millions of people in space one day. So as we look for ways to evolve toward that airline-like model, we look for how we can, you know, cut back on the amount of training that's necessary, while still keeping the crew safe." Now, moving on to our next update about a recent tweeted photograph which possibly shows a part of SpaceX's rocket catcher, Mechazilla. Last Sunday, photographer Nick Answeeney posted photographs of a massive claw-like structure and posted it on Twitter. The giant structure was spotted at a SpaceX launch site in South Texas, and now rumors say that it could be part of SpaceX's rocket catcher, Mechazilla. The structure is reportedly present around a construction site where technicians and engineers were working on Mechazilla. We knew from previous updates how SpaceX was planning to catch rockets using its robot chopsticks. As Musk posted on Twitter back on August 30th, SpaceX will try to catch largest ever flying object with robot chopsticks. There were high hopes on this new massive robot catcher. However, it's still unclear whether the claws spotted in the picture belong to the Mechazilla or if it's just a part of the tower's disconnect arm. A Twitter user posted an animation video last month which somewhat interpreted a tower catching a SpaceX Super Heavy booster as it returns and then sends the rocket to launch stand. Musk replied to the video saying how it was pretty close and also said that in reality the structure will work faster. Musk tweeted, "QD arm will steady booster for shipmate, and ship will be caught by Mechazilla too. As with booster, no landing legs. Those are only needed for Moon and Mars until there's local infrastructure." Some of the users think the claw-like structure is part of the boosters, whereas some believe it to be part of Mechazilla. Now, according to NASA Spaceflight, it's more likely to be part of the chopstick. Finally, today's last update about the new partnership between Japan-based mobile provider KDDI and SpaceX. On September 13th, Japan's major mobile provider, KDDI, has announced a partnership with SpaceX. SpaceX's Starlink satellite broadband service is going to be in Japan from 2022. The partnership is to provide urban mobile connectivity experience to the rural mobile customers. Hiro Mizuno, financial executive director for the Tesla board and a United Nations special envoy on innovative finance and sustainable investments, shared the news report on Twitter. He wrote, "Starlink SpaceX coming to Japanese internet users in remote areas. This will be achieved using its 1,200 remote mobile towers. According to KDD, the first step will be offering Starlink broadband to residents of mountains and islands without extra charges. Moreover, the satellite network will be a backup in case of telecom lines face damage due to certain mishaps." After receiving experimental license from Japan's Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications, both the companies conducted some technical demonstrations and by the end of 2021 aim at receiving a formal license. The financial terms of the agreement aren't yet disclosed, though. There are still areas with incomplete networks. In March, about 9,900 residents were in locations without mobile network coverage, and it's hard to connect with devices from such areas. Over 90% of the population is covered by KDDI with 4G communication. On the other hand, KDDI's competitor, SoftBank, is planning to work with OneWeb in May in order to build advanced seamless connectivity in Japan. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comments section. This will help us to improve.